Good morning, Livingstone.
And it is good to be back before you today, the very last day of the month of February. And this month has been set aside for several years now as Black History Month. And as African Americans, we know that there is rich history throughout this country as a result of God creating not just one race, but created all race. And specifically, the Black race has played a tremendous role in shaping this country that we call home. And so we're excited today that we have set aside today to celebrate Black History Month. So we have a few things on the program, and to top it off, we have our very own Bishop Henry Hearns delivering the word of God today. So I'm excited about that, excited about our history. There's an old saying years ago, they said, say it loud, I'm black and proud. There is nothing wrong with acknowledging who God created, and God created you. You are to be a proud people, and I'm excited about what God is doing in our race and in our country as a result of who we are. And so we have set aside this day to celebrate Black History Month. And one thing that is so important is never forget, as a believer, never forget what our true calling is. Our calling is to be the light in the world that is dark. Our calling is to be different. God never told us to allow the world to come into the church, but he said, let the church go into the world and change the world. And so he says, go ye therefore and teach all nations. In order to do that, you need to leave the church. And so what God has allowed us to do during this COVID virus shutdown, he has allowed us to get outside of these comfortable, beautiful walls and spread the gospel like never before. And so in order to do that, you need to know who God is. And you need to have a heart for God. And there is a anthem that we've been reciting here for many years now. And it is something that we have memorized. But the question is it what you walk? And today, like no other day, this scripture stands tall in my mind. Because when those that look at you differently, are you still able to say, I would bless the Lord? When they look at you with disdain and hate, are you still able to say that I will bless the Lord? It is not a verse out of convenience. In other words, I don't get to say I will bless the Lord at all times when all times are good. But when things are bad, when things are ugly, when things are dark, am I still able to say that I will bless the Lord at all times? And the only way I can say that is I got to know him. I got to be close to him. I got to have a relationship with him. I have to be in love with him. There's a song that came out several years ago that said, falling in love with Jesus is the best thing that I've ever done. And so if you're in love with Jesus, you'll be able to say, like David says, that I will bless the Lord at all times. And so if you're ready to not just recite it, but to outright say that this is my way of life, this is what I walk every day. This is what I live every day. This is my commitment unto my God. If you're ready, let's say it. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make her boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. And let us acknowledge his name together. Amen. 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 Going to bring up Pastor Carter now that he will lead the remainder of this service. Again, we have some things on program that are quite different in honor of Black History Month. Sit back, enjoy, and never stop worshiping, praising God.
Good morning, Livingstone. So good to be here again this morning. And just for protocol, I guess we need to let you see that we are masked up, not just masked up, but double masked. Amen. The announcements for today is the Sunday school books are available in the church office. You need to make a call and get the ones before they get gone. And again, Brother Burrell is teaching an awesome Sunday school class. Also, we started the COVID testing site. Last Thursday was our first day, and they will continue every Tuesday and Thursday until June 29th. Amen. The times are from 11 a.m. to 6 p.m. Here's a big one. The outreach ministry is getting ready to clothe and feed the homeless again, and we're trying to raise $500 by March 14th for supplies. The nights are cold. We still need toiletries, non-perishable food, and then you can make your checks payable to Livingstone Outreach Ministry, or you can come and mail them in or drop them in at the church office. Remember that because of COVID, that if you give anything, they have to be brand new things. If you're going to go buy a coat, amen? And we thank you for that. And also, it's always good to be a giver, right? The Bible says, give, and it shall be given unto you. How? Pressed down, shaken together, and running over shall men give into your bosom, amen? The church doesn't operate by itself, amen? But I thank God for each and every one of you who had a heart to sow seed on good ground of Livingstone, amen? And you can make your payments by PayPal, Zelle. You can bring them in to the church or mail them in. God bless you. Next coming up, we'll have a poem by Sister Sylvia Simpson Dash. Amen, Hearns.
Me want go walk toto. Me want go walk toto. My children were taken from me, taken from my womb, taken from the cradle I made for them. My children were so beautiful. They were so beautiful. Skin black and rich as the soil. Truly royal. I raised them to be proud, powerful, and passionate. But as much as I loved them, I could not protect them. Evil, wicked men from strange lands saw the beauty of my children. They saw the tribal wars, and they took advantage of my children and used my children against each other. Thousands and thousands of my children taken from me, beaten, raped, tortured, sold like animals. But in this, there was divine purpose. They were taken to strange lands, but they learned to sing in a strange land because they found the true and living God, the creator of you, of me, your mother Africa. And oh, how you sang. And he sent you mighty warriors, strong deliverers to help you. Harriet Tubman, John Brown, Martin Luther King, Rosa Parks, the Freedom Riders. Soon, others saw your beauty, and they knew you must be free. They fought with you, and yes, they even died. And for this, I am grateful. And soon, dear children, you became free. And oh, you became African Americans. And there's not one aspect of the culture you did not affect. Math, science, music, the arts. Oh, and how you worshiped your God. How you worshiped your God. And oh, my children, I am so proud of you. But there is one thing you must remember. Never forget where you came from. Never forget where you came from. You are a royal priesthood. Walk in it. Love one another. Respect one another. Respect yourself. Never wear the shameful labels of the past. Keep your head up. your head up. And then you will see where you are going. And with your God before you, you are more than conquerors. I love you.
Here's a video of Desegregation by young Ezekiel, 10 years old. Watch and be blessed.
What are you doing? You cannot play with him anymore. Come on.
Bye.
Bye.
What happened? How come people don't like us because of the color of our skin?
You are as good as anyone. Just believe that.
Whoa!
Ah!
Whoa!
Let's start a bus boycott.
Peaceful?
Yes.
Soon the city lost money because of the bus boycott. And then the city seemed to that bus segregation.
One day, this nation will...
And that's your lesson about Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. and Rosa Parks.
We all need Jews to be self-evident.
In loving memory of Rosa Parks and Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.
Thank you. Down through the years, thank you. mighty long way.
Good morning, Living Stone, and happy Black History Month. Hallelujah. We are glad to be here before you this morning as we are getting set up. And just want to say amen and hallelujah to where God has brought us from. Amen. Lift every voice and sing. Lift every voice and sing till earth and heaven ring. Ring with the harmonies of liberty. Let our rejoicing rise high as the listening skies. Oh, let it resound loud as the rolling sea. Sing a song full of the faith that the dark past has taught us. Sing a song full of the hope that the present has brought us. Facing the till victory is won. God bless you.
What a blessing. I'm so thankful this morning for the opportunity to come before you and Pastor, thank you for allowing this to happen. By the way, I hope you all saw that I came up with my mask on. I'm not one of those who believe that I can go beyond science. Science has told us that we can ward off if we keep ourselves separated from big crowds, wear our masks, wash our hands, and they didn't say this, but I'm going to put this in here, and pray. I believe God can do anything except fail. I'm thankful this morning. Before we get into the word, I'm thankful this morning for the children's department of our church being represented by a little brother who put a little 1 minute and 26 second video together, and I hope you saw it and hope you enjoyed it. And again, Pastor, thank you for allowing that to take place at a little bit later out. So we're thankful for that. And I certainly thank God for my daughter, Sylvia, who can draw tears from me at a,
at a heartbeat, because she's so real with what it is that she represents. And then I could visualize, because I come back in a few minutes, I'll be 88 years old. And so I know, thank you so much. So I know a little bit about the ugliness. I wasn't born a slave, but I was off the heels of slave by being a sharecropper. And I maintain that sharecropping was another level, so-called upper echelon of slavery, because we worked on the white man's farms in Mississippi and the tobacco fields up in Kentucky and other states where we were. So I'm honored for that, and thank you so much, Sylvia, for that. And then our beautiful dancers who told a story on up the line, who made us to know that God has brought us from a mighty long way. And in my way of saying it, he's brought us all the way, because there was nothing we could do without that. And then my daughter, Angela, who is raised by a dad. I keep wanting to make my lie work, but it ain't quite working. But the key thing is God just gifted her with a great voice. And so we are thankful for that. And then it is our turn to share some word with you today on what the church really means. How, and somebody needs to keep time on me here, because I could get lost in this one. And I want to kind of wrap everything I have today around a subject that I'm going to say, let the church say amen. Let the church say amen. And that's going to be put together by the Black Church, the Comforter of the Soul, the Black Church. And so let's ask God to help us with this. Father, we thank you for this opportunity to be here today. And I thank you for what our ears have heard and that part that our eyes have seen. We thank you for that. Now, as we open our thoughts to look back over 400 years, remembering our days of landing somewhere close to 1620 in Jamestown, and how we were bound on the ships, stacked in as sardines. Many didn't make the whole trip. They died aboard the ship on their way to America. And Father, being that you have allowed me to be here in the time that I have been here since 1933. The things that had happened in my life, and when I look back, I want to get evil and ugly. And I'd love to hate those who don't look like me. But you've allowed me to meet your son, Jesus, that had brought about a change in my life, that I cannot hate anybody. And I'm thankful for that. So will you help us to speak to those who will be listening in with us today? In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. There's one of the things that I want to bring forth to you today is really somewhat, I guess I just had never thought of it in that way, but if I don't tear up my system here, but the word got out on Christ far before the Gospels were written. And if you remember, let's run over to Matthew chapter 16 and verse 13 through 18. And I'm not going to read it all, but I'm just going to talk about it. When Jesus got off the boat there in Capernaum, and he met up with his disciples, and he said to them, all I'm trying to do is give you a little background of when the gospel started. He says, who do men say that I am? And they said, they named all of the dead prophets. And finally, Jesus was tired of their discussion, and he says, hold it, guys. I'm getting ready to do something here. So what I'd really like to know is, who do you say that I am? And Peter raised his hand in pride, as many of us preachers do. I did it when I first started off. He said, I know thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And then I can see him kind of popping his suspenders to let everybody know that he knew and nobody else knew. But Jesus looked him in the eye and said, Peter, you didn't know it because you knew it. You knew it because the Father in heaven revealed to you who I am. And upon this rock, and I think Peter might have taken pride in that to say that he was building it upon him. But Jesus did not build the church upon Peter. But he built the church on truth, the testimony that said, thou art the Christ, the Son of a living God. So that's when it all started, brothers and sisters, when Jesus set up the church right there. And we know that without him, that could not have happened. No way that could happen. So nobody else could establish that. Only Jesus could establish the church. And then he goes on to say in that same scripture that he said, upon this rock I'll build my church. And listen to this. And this is the thing that ought to set you free. He says, I will build my church and the gates of hell. In other words, here's the way I'm looking at that. If somebody could open up the gate to hell and let everything in there come against the church, it couldn't prevail. So you see, we are able to say, let the church say, amen. So I'm glad then that the word got out, even in Africa, when Jesus was about to be crucified, if you remember, when a little brother, a little dark brother from Africa was there to help Jesus bear the cross. And y'all got to help me. I don't want to get I don't want to get really excited. I just want to leave some information. But listen what he says. I see a writer stepping out called Dr. Watts. And he goes on to say, must Jesus bear the cross alone and all of the world go free? But he said, no, there's a cross for everyone. And there's a cross for me. Let the church say, we're looking forward and we're thankful that the word got out in Africa. So in 1620, when black America slaves came to Jamestown, I'm believing in my heart that many of them had heard about Jesus, because right in the first century, and Jesus' crucifixion, right after his crucifixion and burial and resurrection, right after that, the word got out. Simeon, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, before the Gospels were written, the Ethiopian who was on his way back home to Africa, and I understand that there were Jews who were sold into slavery, and some of those Jewish Christians went to Africa and shared the story. So, you know, some kind of way, brothers and sisters, there is no way that anyone can stop the gospel. And I hope you'll let me preach again, but I'm about to say something about one of the presidents of the United States of America just recently who lied and said he was a believer, but at the same time saying that he was king and he was the anointed one. So, ladies and gentlemen, I'm excited and realize the fact that the word is out and nobody can stop the gospel of Christ. No matter what happened, nobody can stop it. And I'm glad that this kind of thing has been happening in that way. Well, let me move through some of the things that the church did in the dark days of slavery here in America. And by the way, slavery has always existed at one place or the other, at one time or the other, in many different cultures over hundreds of years. But what I'm talking about today is black history, American history. And we find that the old story was told that if God had not sent or allowed slavery to happen in America, America would not be at the level and strength that it is today. But when they brought these slaves, sold them to different buyers, and while they were with their slave owners, many of the slave owners would take their slaves to the church and sit them in the back rows. Some of them would even sit them in the front rows. But when the blacks got a hold of this, somehow or the other, God allowed the spirit of himself to override their pain, to override being beat up, to override being lynched, to override them having to do all the things that they did, and somehow found peace in the little hooded churches that they had. So we're thankful for that the church is a place, and today And I'm going a little fast here. But today, we need to understand that the church is still valuable. And I want you to know that nobody come from hell or anywhere else is going to be able to stop the church. Well, how can you say that, Henry? Well, here's how I can say it. Because Jesus said it. He said, upon this rock, I will establish my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Let me move down a little further here. The slaves got tangled up with Christianity. And there were, we find out, some of the slave owners wanted to even change the Bible so that they could take advantage of the slavery and make them think it was from God. But I want you to know that somehow or the other, the slaves began to realize that it was Jesus. Yes, he was beat. And they said, well, maybe that fits with us. Jesus was killed, and maybe that fits in with us. But Jesus got up. And so therefore, we are going to get up. And I can hear my old grandparent. I had an opportunity to live with my great-great-granddaddy, who died in 1948 at 112 years old. So that put him way back at the beginning of the century, of the 18th century. And he would sit out and say to us, he said, son, I don't want you all, as you grow up, to ever bow your head. God loves us. God is going to protect us. That's my old great-great-grandfather who grew up and was sold twice. Sold once, separated from his mama. And so what I'm saying to you today, and I'm a little bit scattered on this because I want to really move on down through the end of this and take you to the gospel. Grandpa told us he would sit out behind the house in the shade of the house. And our house, our little shotgun house, was built such that it faced north and south. So when the sun would come up in the morning, we had shade on the west side of the house. And when the sun would get over on the west hemisphere toward California, let me put it that way, we had shade on the other side of the house. So Grandpa would sit out and say to us on a Sunday morning, I want you all to remember what the preacher said, because Grandpa can't go to church. But what did the preacher say? Did he tell you that God made you free? Did he tell you that he sent his son to take your sins? And we would tell Grandpa, and he'd have his walking stick just pecking on the ground. And he remembered the words, even though he was never taught to read. But he would hear the preachers as he's growing up and would remember those scriptures and kept them in his heart as he grew up. So the church grew to the point, and I think it would have been the early change of the century from the 1620s over to now about the 1700s. When the big church, black churches were built, and they began to produce, the church itself began to produce, and I'm going to have a little roll call here, and I want you to remember, how many of you remember Oprah Winfrey? And I probably messed up her name pretty good. But did you know she was taught by her grandparents about the love of Jesus Christ? So she's a product of the church. So the church can say, amen. And I'm saying not only Oprah Winfrey. Lord have mercy, forgive me, Oprah. Then we have another person who could sing, and her daddy was a great preacher. C.L. Franklin was one of the greatest preachers ever walked in terms of the old time gospel preaching. He had a sermon that I still play sometime called "The Eagle Stirs Her Nest." But there's his daughter, Aretha Franklin, who know that she could sing. And they wanted to put her out of the church because she could make people dance even in the ballroom floors because of her ability to sing. But she's a product of the church. So let the church say amen. Then you have a little brother that grew up and walked across the bridge on Bloody Sunday by the name of John Lewis. John Lewis is a product of the church. And I think it was last year, I believe, that he passed away. And before he did, he asked them to take him, and they took him out on the side, and he looked way over across the field and saw the sign saying, "Black Lives Matter." See, I'm about to lose it up in here. But John Lewis stood there, watering it, tears in his eyes, making a statement and saying, "Yes, Black Lives Matter, I won't be able to get all the way there. But some kind of way, God is going to bring them through." And he said, "Let the church say amen." Then we have another one, Sam Cooke. You all know Sam Cooke. He can sing gospel, and he can sing other stuff. But he could do it. But he's a product of the church. Then we come on down looking for freedom and the civil rights bill. And that was a little black guy at 29 years old. Was able to come forth and get with the president of that day and was able to get the civil rights bill passed. His name was Dr. Martin Luther King. Martin Luther King, I believe, born in 1929, I think it was, somewhere in there. January 15, somewhere in there. And we're so thankful I had a son, Hugo, was born in that month, January 15th, except a different year. So Martin Luther King, led of the Lord, here he is also a product of the church. So nowhere can we go. Nothing we can find that is worth anything didn't somehow or the other come through the church. There was the Clark sisters. That was Sinbad. Messing up his name pretty good for him, too. Sinbad. And then you have the Pointer sisters. Jamie Foxx. Ray Charles. Even Johnny Cochran is a product of the church. Then we find that the church began to produce educational system. And they began, one of the great churches, great schools that we have is Morehouse College. Come right out of the CME church, I believe. Then we have Clark's College. Spelman University. Let the church say amen. Then we have, and I didn't notice until recently, that Howard University, there was a bunch of missionaries got together and said, "Our preachers need to be trained." And this is one of the things, Pastor, I hope that we don't forget in the Baptist churches, that majority of these schools were set up by the AME and CME churches because they believed in education. And so Howard University was set up to train preachers by a bunch of missionaries. Tuskegee Institute, Morris Brown, all of these universities were set up. And I even find out that Fisk University come out of the church. So let the church say amen. So I want you to know that the church is going to last, brothers and sisters. There ain't nothing else that's going to stand. But everything that we see, this beautiful building that we're in, and all the other things that we come in contact with, that we can see with our eyes, hear with our ears, smell with our smell, taste with our taste, is going to fade away, but not the church. Not the church. The church is going to last. Let me tell you, as we move along, we see that the historical black colleges and universities come out of the church, and we've already covered that. Then we find out that the church will last no matter what. The message, listen to this, the message is the same as it was when Jesus spoke it. But we have to, Brother Pastor, Brother Henry, and Brother or Sisters, everybody, wherever you are, we've got to recognize the method of presenting the word has to change with the technology. We cannot overlook the technology. We've got to use technology. And this morning, you are seeing or listening to what's going on here in Living Stone Cathedral of Worship. You're listening through the technology that has been provided. So the church must change its methods, but not the message. The message has to stand. So ladies and gentlemen, as we close this message, I want you to know that in Romans chapter 8 and verse 28 says that, for we know that all things work together for good for those who love God and are called according to his purpose. So what are you saying, Bishop? I'm saying that slavery, even though that God may not have ordained it, but he allowed it to happen for the good of the gospel. And so I'm saying to you, no matter what you are going through, don't let nothing stop you from delivering the gospel by your way of thinking, by your way of teaching, your way of loving, the way you smile, the way you talk, the way you treat people. You've got to make sure that you present the Lord Jesus wherever you go. Well, then we find Acts chapter 8 in the first four verses that the church was persecuted. But when the church was persecuted, it grew. Even the apostles who would not leave Jerusalem, but when the thing broke out, persecution started, them fellows had to get out and hit the street. And when they did, they went everywhere preaching the gospel. Even Paul got caught on his way to Damascus. Lord have mercy. And when he got caught on his way to Damascus and got knocked down, when he got up, he was blinded. But a preacher named Ananias was told by the Holy Spirit to go and give him his sight back. Ananias said, "Oh, Lord, he's a bad guy. He's a tricky man." But the Holy Ghost said, "No, but he's been touched. He's been touched. He's a changed man." because behold, he prayed. So that then Paul went everywhere preaching and teaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. So I want to say to you in closing today that Jesus died on Calvary for the remission of our sin. And you know what? It didn't have anything to do with how we treated him. It had all to do with how much he loved us. So I want to say to you today that don't forget that the black church today is here to stay. And I'm not saying that we need to stay separate. I'm not saying that at all. But I am saying that what God has blessed us with is somehow or the other. Ain't no other culture has been able to stand out. I think it was Roland Hayes. I'm about to get into some stuff I don't know about. But I think it was Roland Hayes, wasn't it? The black guy who first sung in Carnegie Hall. Or it was Paul Robeson. But this guy had a voice, and they yelled after him to get off the stage. But when the brother opened his mouth and began to raise that beautiful voice of his, the people got quiet and they received the word. So I'm saying to you, and I have been gifted to reach out for our white brothers and sisters, our brown brothers and sisters, with all the love that we have in our heart. We need to reach out. And we cannot back and talk about what God has given us and then run off in a little side show to ourselves. But we got to love everybody. Closing. I got to close now. Let's look at John chapter 13. Verse 34 and 35. Everybody knows that one. I hear Jesus saying this. A new commandment, verse 34, I give unto you that you love one another as I have loved you. A new commandment, no longer an eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth, but I've given you commandment to love as I have loved you. And then he says, when men and women in the world, even in the 21st century, see you, they'll know you are mine because of your love one to another. If there's anybody out there listening to me today, we're so fortunate. I'm about to say something. It's making me a little nervous to say it, but I feel impressed to say it. But I'm glad and proud to be a black man. And I'm proud and thankful to know that I have a mission. And the mission is to first love. Not just those who love me, but every heart needs a touch of God. And God has assigned me to do it. He's assigned you to do it. So don't forget to love. I want to say this, if there's anybody who's heard this word, it was meant to give you some touches and spots of history, but particularly what the church and the black church has done. But I want you to know that the gospel is for the saving of the soul. In Jesus' name, Father, I come to you now, praying for those who heard the word, praying for those who have another thought, praying for those who do not know who you are. And if there's anybody who's listening to me wherever, who is still in a hate mode because of how they've been treated, Lord, help them as you helped me to overcome that and recognize the fact it's time to love. That's what the church is all about. God bless them. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Bless you, Pastor.
Amen. Let the church say amen. Thank you so much, Bishop. Just reiterate the rich history that we have. And not by chance, but it was by divine ordinance of God himself that God has brought us from where we were to where we are. And if God has brought us from where we were to where we are, he's going to take us to where we need to be. Continue to trust in God. Continue to believe in God and to know that God has not left us, nor will he ever leave us, but that he would walk with us all the way until we reach our ultimate destination, face to face with our Savior. Until then, there is work to be done. Until then, there is love to be done, Bishop. As Bishop told us that in spite of what the world is doing, in spite of the hate that's in this world, God has mandated his children to love. He has mandated his children to be the difference, not to fit in with the crowd, not to do what the crowd is doing, but to continue to love as Christ has loved us, to be that example, to be that light that shines, to be the difference in this Antelope Valley, so much so that in spite of them hating you, you continue to love and you draw them. And so we're grateful to God for the word of God today by God's man, God's messenger, Bishop Henry Hearns. Well, Livingstone, thank you so much as we end this celebration month, Black History Month, but we don't end the celebration of Black heritage or Black history. We continue to evolve, we continue to grow, we continue to make a difference, continue to have an impact, that no matter what the world throws at us, we get stronger. And we get stronger because of the God that we serve and what God has done for us. So look forward to seeing you guys again next week as we continue. We into a brand new month starting tomorrow. March is upon us, and as March comes upon us, it will be one full year since COVID has hit us and caused us to shift and make a difference. A year has passed, and so we look forward to what God is going to do in this year, 2021. Father, in the name of Jesus, we give you praise, we give you thanks. God, thank you so much for your word and your messenger, your talented people, God, by way of script and by way of music and by way of demonstration, God. You continue to develop us. You continue to uplift us, and you continue to bless us. And God, I pray that the gifts would not stop, but they will continue to pour into this body. And as they pour in, God, we make a difference in this community and draw this community not close to us, but closer to you. And so, Father, we give you praise today. We give you thanks today. It is in Jesus' wonderful and holy name. Let the church say, amen.